in tone and color, but simplified, but accurate. So he didn't mind what you read or what you didn't read. He was studying the world. And I didn't realize at that time, and I said, why am I studying with this person? And it was a realization that there's ways of dealing with the world in paint that I never had run into before. And he gave a very thorough background, very simple, and you could listen or not listen, you could do whatever you wanted. He was very democratic, and he encouraged people. He was a true teacher, and I don't know how to, all this world that I managed to study under him, because the other, last week, 2 weeks ago, we were in London, and we went to see the Elgin Marbles. And my Zach, my son-in-law-to-be, is getting lessons from me on art. So the art was, this is the first time, I'd given him a book a couple years ago that for Christmas, there was 30,000 years of art. And I thought it was just up his alley. And I was gonna test him if he read all of it and looked at all of it and all that. But all it was is that it was one example from each epoch, all the way up to present day. And I thought it was a wonderful thing. I loved the book. I still don't know what his relation regards are of the book. We'll have to talk about it. But I wanted to give him some sensible discourse. And the discourse was phenomenal to myself because I figured out the complete realization, accurate realization of the figure was done in Greece under, who was it? Praxiteles? No, Praxiteles was the, who was the, she's trying to tell me something.
Pericles,
thank you. Under the aegis of Pericles, they had put together all of the knowledge and made a group of artists, the most outstanding in history because it affected everybody since. So that happened then. Then I took him to the National Gallery, and we went to see early Renaissance. Because you know what happened between the Greeks and the Renaissance? The Romans took over and they lost power and everything went wild and the art went wild too. They did not continue the thread of being talented and understanding nature for what it was. But they had other things going on, icons and all that. But then came the early Renaissance and they really did evolve from the Greeks. They really did evolve in paint. We don't know what paintings they painted like, because we don't have any examples of what the Greeks painted like, but it must have been realistic. And so I gave him this sort of sensible tour, and now we're going to do something at the Met in a little while. But the thing was, it dawned on me that I respected that, and I was part of my life deeply, because after having a lunch with Clement Greenberg, who told me that, this was the time of Pollock in the 50s, after having a lunch with Greenberg, he told me that art could not be made up out of figures, you know, abstract art. And that didn't sit well with me. So I went back and did my little black paintings that I was doing at the time. And since then I've seen that whatever I've done has revolved around the real world and some continuation of the growth of understanding and using skill and knowledge to make the real world. What was amazing about the Elgin Marbles was that you would see the legs of horses, you know, they're running or something like that, and in back of them, there are other legs going on, and you're thinking, that's design. They're doing designing. People were not very innovative about how to put things together. I'm interested in design because I have to organize them. At that point, I finished working with Dickinson and I went to Yale. And at Yale, I was starting to free up and try to figure out who I was and how to make paint. And this is one of the samples I used to turn out. This is a one sitting painting that I was turning out like two a day, and they didn't know what to do with me. They certainly didn't help me at all. But it was very interesting. And the other thing that happened at that time was I took Joseph Albers' course in color. And these are two examples. This was a copy of that Goya painting that I loved so much. And I didn't cut paper. But that wasn't really the issue. The issue was that I had to do abstract work. And I don't do it. So I went to movies for about a month. So I started working on some things. And I found out it's not so difficult. And I was up till 4 a.m. turning the papers this way and that way and figuring out what I liked was okay. If I liked it, it was okay. So I kept on doing things that I liked. And this is an example of that. I think that the leaves are a little bit faded since 1961. But that opened my eyes up that there's nothing too bad about abstract work, except I don't like it and I don't do it. And I do what I do. So I like that a lot. And this came a little bit closer to it because it was figurative. And then after that, when I was working, I was doing things from the landscape, but necessarily they were trying to be accurate. Being accurate is not so easy. And it's hard to think about art at the same time of being accurate. It took me a few years to understand it, except when I went out, took potluck, and did whatever I liked. But to make serious painting wasn't an easy idea. So I started figuring out that I had to understand the science of art, the practical part of it. And when I was teaching at Carnegie Tech, I was working on a painting, and I said, well, I'm having trouble understanding. Light tones are very hard to give them color, very hard. And to relate them to other ones, I said, if I could paint a painting in some sort of order, I'll start with the lightest light, and when I get up to the darkest dark, the painting will be covered. So I started doing that, and it set up some sort of thinking mechanism that helped me figure out how to make light tones. When you're dealing with a light tone here and a light tone there, they're different. And all of a sudden, that's all you think about, and you can feel the taste and color change. So I did that for a while until I got bored with it and I just went to straight painting. The second thing happened was when I was kept on doing these fast paintings. I would do any size, any time. I would go out in the morning and do one. And I found out that my big paintings were getting pasty and dull. But the little ones were lively. So I was trying to figure out how to put it together. So this is what I figured out. What I would do, I would do a drawing of the whole canvas. And then one day I would go in and I would paint one section. But the section had to be completely finished for the rest of the painting. I had to be able to think that way. And I did. I was able to do it. I was able to put a spot here or a spot there or a spot here completely finished like a monk. I was religious about it. I could not touch it. It had to work. Well, the beginning ones were a little bit confusing, a little bit muddy, but it's like anything else. Once you hook onto something and work at it, you improve it. So I got to a point, there's a wonderful painting. I hate to say this about myself, but there was a wonderful painting I did.
I say that all the time, so it's okay.
Yeah, it's okay. I did this large painting here on when I could double park, when the meter maids did. I would work inside my truck because I worked in from observation. So I was working that Commonwealth School struck my fancy. So I stretched, what was it, 50 by 80 inch canvas, and I drew it. It took me 2 weeks to draw it. And what happened was, there was a little tree there coming up, one between the two doors. It's big now, but then it was a wonderful little tree. I paid no attention to it. It was wintertime, there was nothing going on. So I was just painting the building. And when I finished the drawing and went up to paint it, I was shocked spring had come. And there were these little gorgeous flowers all over it. All over it. It was only about this big. All over it. And wonderful colors. And they, I said, I was doing this business. This was the crux of it. This finished the whole idea. Is that I had to paint one part. And I said, well, if I like those flowers on the tree. But if I do the flowers, it's got to be sunny tomorrow. And it's got to be, petals still have to be there. Otherwise, this doesn't work. Well, it worked because it was sunny the next day and it was also a nice day. So what happened was the mute mates didn't bother me. I was at a double park and I'm working on the tree, but the tree has a doorway behind it with a door with reflections and brick on it and sunlight coming in the bottom of that. For me to, then I could put the leaves of the tree over that. I mean, simple mechanics, right? You put something down, you put something over. So I got half the tree down, and it had to be there the next day, and it was there the next day, and I finished the tree. And it's the most virtuoso thing I ever accomplished in my life, because I wasn't afraid, but I had to do it, so I was driven to do it, and I did it. And that was the way I was working. Any other part was the same way, whatever the fillings, whatever the reflections were. I did it at the time. If it changed, I didn't care. I'm not a scientist, I'm a painter. So that was the second thing that I found out. But what happened there is that it didn't last too long. As usual, these ideas don't last forever, and you've got to grow with it. And I found out the color wasn't that good. I had to spend more time on the color, and to spend more time on the color, I had to rework it. So I started to lose the virtuosity that I had as a genius, a youthful genius, and I had to go in plugging around. So that was some of the big ideas that I was working with that affected me. There were practical issues, you know? But I found out that it was getting acquainted to painting. It wasn't just that this was one idea, that's another idea. They all have to do specifically with painting. And I was solving them, and I think that's what one does. One doesn't expect to reach the point I have now and doing something that I can't even talk to you about, because it's a secret. I'm working from a photograph. I have to confess. What it is that in 1967 I worked from photographs from National Geographic for the whole summer. I did all of these paintings, small paintings, and I thought I did it pretty well. But I looked at them and said, you know, they look just like photographs. They don't look like a painting. So I've gotten to the point in life in trying to figure out all these issues that I've forgotten what a photograph looks like. And I can't even remember it while I'm looking at it. I'm still painting the outside and I'm used to the outside and I paint like the outside. You know, I paint very complicated, very difficult, exact tones. And then it begins to be something after a while. And I never know. People think that I have a real way of painting. I don't have an idea what I'm doing. Before I get started, I know what I want to paint, and I get started with it, and it starts to evoke an issue. And then all of a sudden, it describes itself to me, and I find out what the problems are and what I'm really going after, but the idea that I had about it is lost completely, and I've got the real idea of painting going on. So that's the biography that I wanted to explain to you, something in the process that leads up to all these things. Now, you ready for questions?
I have one question. What is the real idea? Because I'm an abstract.
What's the real idea of?
What's the real idea, yes.
Of what?
Of what you do. You say the what? Real idea. What is the real idea?
I don't know. I've been painting all my life. I just paint.
No, but you said something about the real idea. You don't know.
Oh, no. Everyone has its own uniqueness. And it presents itself, and I tried to organize it, and I tried to find good color in it, and I've designed it before I even start. I've got these things to help me. See that? That's the best. This size may be better.
Great piece of art, I think.
What it is a finer. Now, the finer is a wonderful gadget because As soon as I do this, you're on a flat canvas. Mm-hmm. I've got a design going. I've got something going already as soon as I look through that. But I ran into trouble one painting. It was a complicated setup. One of the stores I was doing was below and the up above, you know, the walkway that goes underneath the stores down here a ways. Very complicated, and it was a 40 by 60. I worked on the drawing for 2 weeks. I was having trouble. And it looked all wrong to me because I hadn't seen that before. Anything that you haven't seen before, things bending, doing different things in different places, is wrong if you haven't done it before. If you haven't done it before. Mm-hmm. To understand it and use it, you have to have done it, you know? So I made this. I made this one and put all those squares in it. Erased the whole drawing, spent another week drawing it, and it came out exactly the same. It was, I mean, I could draw, I guess, to a degree, you know, I could draw, but I didn't realize that. But that's the remarkable thing about this thing. It translates the world into a flat thing right away, and then you can start designing it. Well, I use it now still, but I have an iPad where I look at things from different angles. And instead of spending a lot of gas going back and forth and a lot of drawings, I just take a lot of angles, go back home and figure it out. And then I come back there and paint it. That's a long answer. Is that the answer wanted?
No, but sometimes we hear you because when I paint, I'm in front of a white, huge canvas that I want to be in so small. And I have no idea what I'm going to be doing. No idea. And I couldn't go through all that stuff. I just have to.
No, no, you do. I'm not telling you how to paint. I'm
telling you what
I have done.
Yeah, yeah, no.
What my needs were.
Yeah, yeah, I understand that. But it's just interesting to say that, you know.
Well, you don't need that.
No. No, but.
This is for translating that world.
I know I don't need it, but you know, sometimes it might be a good idea to use it for art. You know.
Yeah, and if I can too.
I like your gadget. I'm going to try that anyway.
Well, it's two L-shaped pieces of cardboard because they have different shapes.
You sign it and give it to me.
Pardon?
Sign it and give it to me.
No, this is precious. This will cost a fortune.
I don't.
Yes.
I have a question about your flowers.
The flowers?
You were doing in front of a communist school.
Oh, yeah.
And you said, I thought.
They were all flowering fruit, you know.
Right. But I thought you said that you were still doing little sections that had to be complete.
Yeah.
And I also thought you said that the flowers were overlaid, the reflections, and the complicated door behind it.
Yeah.
So you didn't do the flowers first, did you?
Are you crazy?
That's what I thought.
I'm not a neat painter, you know. I need desperate things. I painted the whole background,
okay.
And then over it. But you understand, it's all wet, and I can't make any mistakes.
So that's
not like today. I make a lot of mistakes, and I couldn't do
many
that.
Many different things going on. It wasn't just one area of color. It was a very complicated.
Oh yeah, complicated section. Doorway.
Thank you.
And this branch was going out there,
right.
And then I had the branch. That's easy. But then all the full nuances you have there.
Yep.
I just went along, didn't trust I could do it, but
and
it
you
came
did.
On.
Thank you.
Yes.
So I've seen one or two paintings that you've done of self-portrait, I think one of your daughter maybe, of people, but you don't really paint people, is that right?
Sure I do. What do you mean I don't really paint people?
No, I mean...
They're not real people?
This is not what...
Listen, if you all could sit still for a month, I could make a good painting out of you right here.
I volunteer.
Yeah.
Is that a question?
No. A statement.
Is that it? We're done? Yep.
I have a few questions.
A few? Okay.
Yeah, sorry.
Start.
To begin, you mentioned Joseph Albers.
Yeah.
I'm curious about his understanding of color, its connection with
you have to talk to him.
Dickinson's.
I have an answer for him.
Okay.
Because I have a specific thought about it.
Okay. But did you find,
Oh, he had actually retired the year before. This was the residue of all his students. They were teaching the course. And in fact, my first teaching, I taught the color course because there's a book and you can anybody can teach from
yeah.
that.
Okay.
Except the free studies. This was a free study. You had to invent something and put things together and sort of make some logic out of it.
Okay.
Correct.
So can you speak more about studying with Dickinson and specifically how he was teaching the color spot technique? Now, I read Hawthorne.
No. It's not a color spot technique. They dreamt that up.
Is that okay? I've read that specifically from Francis.
Everybody, you know, it's like an accident. Everybody sees something different. Mm-hmm. I have good friends that I went to school with. Well, Leonard Anderson was one of them that I went to school with. Mm-hmm. And he has a completely different idea of what Dickinson taught. Mm-hmm. Because the first class I had with him was at a night course at the Brooklyn Museum. And I was there with a lot of people who had other jobs. And they were doing this class. And at one point he said, I would help you do anything you want. One woman put up her hand and said, would you teach me to paint like an impressionist? He said, of course. He went over there and started helping her. And I don't know what happened next, but I must have made a ferocious look or grumped or something like this, because when everybody had left, George, he came up to me and he said, George, there's room for everybody. Was I answering something?
Somewhat.
Oh, about his teaching. You could work from the model, or you didn't have to work. We had a model what's that called, that school there? I forgot the name of the school. On 57th Street.
Art Students League?
Art Students League. Listen, I've lost it, so don't pay attention to that. Had this room upstairs which was painted all white, and he didn't allow any lights. He had natural light because we're facing north. The light was very stable. But on a dark, wintry day, you couldn't see the corners of the room. It was so dark. I mean, really, nature is surprising at times. So, and he never changed the pose. The pose like that forever. You know, that was the model. She came in and she posed. That was the pose. So if you wanted to have another angle, you just move someplace else. In fact, we went to be desperate. We had to be entertained, of course, so we built a big table, and we went up on top, the painter from the top looking down, because the model had to be in that pose. But it was amazing. I saw him construct that. A lady was working on a head. She just had the drawing, she didn't know how to go. So he took his little finger in the palette and he started making a nose like this. And pretty soon there was this beautiful nose. You know, wet paint thinking, tonally, color, and drawing, thinking it all, and just doing it. He'd give examples like that, but we had a drawing session that was hardly what anyone considers a drawing session. It was 3 minutes. The model was up there. All you had to draw was one line of the contour, somewhere here, someplace. He would come up there and correct it. Come up and he would know exactly where it was on the figure and this and that. That was his idea of a drawing course. Because drawings, that's not enough for most people. But if you can do that accurately, you can draw anything. See, we didn't have common sense at that time. Is that enough of the things? There were things about, 1 minute. I'll remember. You got a nice sweater. I remember that we once went, he never talked about his work, never. So at one point, they had let out at the same time in the Whitney, in the Modern Museum of Art, and at the, the Metropolitan? MoMA, Metropolitan, and they had let out three of his paintings. They hung them all at once, and one of them said, there were only 8 students in the class. He said, why don't we all go to the museum now, and you take us, And we can all, we can talk, they want him to talk. We can all talk about the work, whatever you like. So we went there, and there was this big painting with a nude and some steps and some water and something falling in there. And he said, this is the only thing he said about the painting. He said, there's some sort of curve, parabolic curves on the water, and I drew that very accurately, he said. And then he painted it. And then he said, you know, a critic in the paper said that this hot, is either a hot coal or a rose falling through the steps. And we went up there to look at it, and we came back and he left. That's all he was going to say, what somebody else said about it. Yes?
George, you sometimes refer to painting as solving a problem or solving a collection of problems.
Well, I said the process.
The process.
Yes.
Is a process of solving.
It's a craft.
Yes. What happens when you get stuck in a problem? Or how do you get beyond being stuck in a problem?
Well, did you ever think of falling over a waterfall into a boiling pot of oil? That's what it feels like. I mean, it's desperate. It's very anxious. When I'm not very happy sometimes, it's because I failed at what I was trying to do today. So I have to scrape it off and go again. No, there's a high bit of concentration going on. And there's a high bit of focus going on. And the point is, when you finish, there's no more problems, no more issues. And I abandon paintings because there's nothing else to do. I don't know they're perfect or not, but I don't know what else to do. I only work on a painting as long as I can. I mean, I have gotten statements from my family saying, stop working on it, you're going to wreck it, you know? And I would work another month on it or something like that. Because I said this at the last talk that we had a couple of years ago, but I love this. Pablo Casals, a cello player, he was interviewed, and he was asked at 92. He was interviewed, and they asked him the question. We understand you practice this afternoon. He said, "I practice every afternoon." And he said, "But why do you do that? All the success, all that you've done, does that?" He said, "You know, today, I noticed a little improvement. You know that improvement? Nobody else in the world could recognize or know, but he's involved with it, and he knows he improved. And that's a driving factor."
Maybe somebody else might have thinking, yeah.
Yeah.
What kinds of subjects are you working on now, or thinking about working on now?
There were some red flowers I took a picture of the other day. They weren't really red. What's the name of that plant? Sit by the window? Okay, well, anyway, I saw that. That's in the back of my mind. That means it's going to happen. Because I took a couple pictures of it, and I've been thinking about it. So it's on the ledge there to fall.
Yeah.
So the other thing is that the quarry over there in North Andover where I'm working, the man is wonderful. One of the few people that support art, I think, because he supports me in doing anything I want. This was painted there, and he gave me permission. Not only gave me permission, he gave me keys so I get in there on Sundays when they're closed and all that kind of stuff. And I was going down to look over and get my winter. I have a truck that I painted in the wintertime with a window on it. So I was getting ready for my winter agenda, and I went down there. I called up and I said, "Can I?" He said, "Don't come down now. They're blasting. We're blasting." So I know what that means. So I kept away. So a couple days later, I went down there, and they were through blasting, but they had all these big machines grinding the granite from one to the other. You know, all that kind of stuff. And I was admiring some big cliffs there. And I said, "Oh, I can come back here in the summertime. I think I'll go back now and look at what these old machines." That big one is from one.
Yeah, you've done that forever, the machines.
Well, I started in 1937.
Yeah.
I haven't forgotten. My father had a 37 Ford and I did a watercolor thing. I wonder what happened to that.
Yeah.
Anyway, then I went around to where the spot was. There's one entrance that, you know, it's, those cliffs are very tall, they're like 60 feet tall, which they've destroyed, and now they're breaking them down into smaller pieces. And at the top of that, where I went around there, the little road that was he'd cleaned out for me before wasn't there, because there was a 60-foot hole right there. And I could walk around, but with all my equipment in the wintertime, it's not possible. So I was shy of asking, so I called him up and I asked him if, you know, I can't get to the road and I wanted to plant something there. He already announced it. And he said, well, I'll make a road for you. Come in a couple of weeks and I'll plant it. He's got a machine that has wheels this big. He lifts up boulders like this and he does all, he's one-armed, he's a wonderful fellow. But he'll do anything for me, so I keep on giving him more to do. Did I answer something?
Yes, thank you.
Is that it?
Another question.
What's the other question?
Can you speak about how you select your motif?
I can't tell you that. I have no idea.
Okay.
You have no idea? I mean, I want to paint the world. I thought before, when I left Yale, I thought to myself, I can paint anything. And then later on, I found out, I want to paint everything. Not anything, but I want to paint it. I mean, there's no time that I'm walking down the street that I don't see something that I haven't seen before, and all of a sudden it's a new idea. Because I'm like a doctor, I'm on call. Right? Right. You're all going to sleep now.
So presumably you work out many problems as you work through all these paintings. So as you look around at your work, which is the piece in this room that you feel most connected
that
to?
That one and that one.
Wait,
which
that
one?
And that one.
Can you explain why?
Yeah, they're perfect.
You said that one, which one over there?
What?
Which one over there?
Oh, the little one.
And that one there?
Yeah, the one, nobody knows what that is. What I was doing Magnolia Rocks, and I found one of these broken down things, and it's a broken float from a lobster trap, you know. And it came out like that. I said, that could be something. And my wife said, you're bringing junk to paint now? I painted this before, and I like this something. And the thing was, that's the second painting. The first painting I was working on was in the sunlight. This is not in the sunlight, it's a gray light. But the thing is, the colors are very different. I was painting that, and then I stood off at the side. I was working on the other one for a couple of weeks. I stood on the side and looked at it. And I said, I should have done it from this angle. Look how those things work together. You know? And that's what it was. That's the other one. There's some resonances in the color. You know, that's a machine that's a stump grinder. And we had this fellow that ground our stump. And I looked at the magnificent machine where he was making it go back and forth and going back and sideways like that. And I said, that's terrific. I'd like to paint this. And he said, no, I like that yellow. And then he found out I was a painter. And he invited me over to his place. And he would not paint, he would not go out and work with this on sunny days if he knew I was coming in and painting it. Because I could only work on it. And what he would do, because this machine is ferocious, you don't understand how many RPMs that thing has. And these are all little things that dig out granite, for God's sake. And he has these little wires that control the thing. It goes back and forth and sideways. And the thing goes at a ferocious rate, and it will burn up if it's not constantly greased. So the grease that he puts over there goes over the whole thing. So he saw me wiping it one day, and he said, George, you don't have to do that. So he started cleaning it. Of course, I was brought up by my wife to be clean, so I'm a much better cleaner than he is. So I had to clean the whole thing off. But there's still a residue in that color that I never saw before, and I wanted to find. It took me 3 months to find.
I do have a lot of questions, actually.
Yeah, I do.
Are you going to speak louder so they can all hear you?
Oh, sorry. I do have a lot of questions, actually. I was wondering, when you sell a painting...
When I what?
When you sell a painting...
Yeah.
Do you have the idea of the price? Or, let's say, if I do something,
Well, if I could, I'd sell them for $1 million, you know.
Yeah, well, this
but
yeah,
I know,
but we can't, so, but.
But what? What's the question?
Well, my question is, let's say I have a painting and I look at it and I say, okay, that's 50,000, definitely. But of course, you have to do some thousand of it now, but. Do you
well,
have
I can't
an
talk
idea?
Money in here.
Do you have an idea what you want for your painting? I
too
mean,
much
I,
money.
Yeah, I know, I know, but.
No, I can't, it's not to be discussed here.
No?
No. If you want to talk about businesses, talk about the Da Vinci painting they sold for $450 million.
Yeah, I know.
You know?
Well, I know what I'm talking about.
My Zach wrote to me when I thought about it, then I wrote to him a little bit. He says, well, what percentage of it do you think it is? And I said, well, if they have the papers for it from the 16th century, and it's really was that painting, somebody has painted it so much and cleaned it so much, overcleaned it, that there's nothing of Da Vinci there. In fact, I don't think there's anything of Da Vinci there in the beginning, behind the drawing, who would, with a ball like that. I mean, he's not cornball like that. I mean, give him a break. And so he wrote back to me, so what's the percentage? I told him, well, if it's that, it's a genuine Da Vinci, but it's nothing, it's worth nothing, because it's not there anymore. And if it's not, it's just junk. You know.
Yeah, all those big painting.
That's all we're going to talk about, money.
Yeah. No, not all those painting were so, you know, top, right?
They're what?
Oh, never mind.
Any questions about my painting?
This early Dickinson painting, was that all the actual setup, or?
You mean that animal?
Yeah.
You believe that I had a real animal like that? That's the problem. Well,
I was curious.
This was a girl I knew. This was the flower I bought at on Greenwich Avenue in a flower shop. And my friend had this that he had gotten from, oh God, one of those big stores, regular store that also has art. A big store, I can't think of it.
Yeah, Sears.
What?
Piano? No.
I don't know what you said.
I'm French. What do you want?
What's your accent?
I'm French.
Oh no.
I'm French and I'm
not. I don't know French.
Not
what?
A gallery.
What?
Not a gallery.
Not a gallery. A department store.
Sears.
What?
Sears.
Macy's.
Not that role.
Bloomingdale's.
Not Bloomingdale's. There's one that always on Fifth Avenue and about 46th and 48th.
Saks Fifth Avenue.
What?
Saks Fifth Avenue.
No.
Macy's.
Something like that. Anyway, he bought it there. He bought this. This is the bronze. I mean, it's a beautiful bronze. And it's dark like that on this wonderful marble. And I put it on a cart and brought it over to Libby, painted. And when I was returning it at night, some cops stopped me. You know what painters dress like? With this thing? But when I started talking about art, they said, oh, okay. But then the folds, of course, were all there. Mm-hmm. Everything was there except that creature, that's all.
So
and,
where did the creature
she didn't sit too long anyway. What?
Where did the creature come from? What's the creature with the
I don't know. I don't know what I was thinking about then.
It's like Venetian almost.
I had ideas of doing visual opera at the time.
Visual.
And I was doing different kinds of figures. That's where these things come in.
Right.
This, I see, I forgot to talk about this. These were in between, I would do made up things in between of doing scientific paintings, you know. I would do these things, and I always liked these, and I thought they had something to do with that, but that was like the kind of stuff you do every once in a while. Yes?
I have a question. When you were talking about these days, you use your iPad to take photos to help you with the drawing so you don't have to.
No, not help me with the drawing.
Oh, okay.
Tell me with the idea
help
of what I'm going
to
do.
Okay.
I wouldn't draw from that. I'm only doing that now because I freaked out.
Okay.
So.
What? I was leading up to ask you the question, which is to do with color. Do you use photographs ever to arrive at the color?
Never, only today. I was working on a Moroccan Robin this morning.
Right. So you always,
it's turning into ugly paint, so I'm on my way.
Right. So you always have the color in front of you to.
Yeah, I work from observation, you know, when the sun moves, and I like sun lit things, so I'm in a lot of trouble all the time. I sometimes put an addition of events. This is this way at this time of the day, and this is another time of the day, but I can make a painting look like a painting. There are no scientists out there looking at paintings. Can I say that?
To go off of the endless dilemma of time of day and painting in the landscape and how it's constantly changing, you're obviously painting the changes.
Get the question.
There. I'm trying to think of what my question is. I had a different question. Let me just go back to that. So for your still lifes, do you set them up or do you find them that way?
No, I set them up.
You set them up. Mm-hmm. How do you think that extension of yourself into setting something up relates to finding what's in the landscape?
And there's no relationship.
There's no relationship there?
No, I mean, I'm controlling it all, and there I'm taking what I can find and make something out of it.
Mm-hmm. Well, then you're an abstract.
What?
That's abstract. What you just say is abstract.
Everything is abstract,
yeah.
Okay? But I like figures, and I like the real world, and I want to make the real world. I'm not going to make something that is not the real world. Mm-hmm. But everything, all this isn't the real world, you know,
yeah.
That's the sense.
So,
yes?
I just want to make sure I heard you correctly. I believe what you just said was, it's turned into ugly paint, so I know I'm on my way. And
you don't believe that?
I think that's very cool, actually.
It's real.
Unreal.
It's ugly all the time until it isn't ugly and you're done. It looks good. But to get to it, you have to manipulate. You have to move. You have to readjust. But you don't know what you're readjusting. Just inside, it feels better. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'm intrigued by the amount of sky you're showing in your rock painting there.
Well, that's a little drama, Shakespearean drama. Why?
I'm intrigued by that because when I cover it up, that it kind of isn't as perfect as when it's there. So I think that it was the size.
Well, I it was up higher and this and that, and I had painted it down about this big before.
Mm-hmm.
But I said, not too much, a little bit less. I mean, you practice after a while, you have your own judgment to go back on. You can't go back on anybody else's. You have to go back on your own, and you figure out, honestly, how you feel about it. The whole thing is in the relationships and the shapes are things that you end up relating to.
Mm-hmm.
And you like some things more than other things. The shapes, colors, the tones, the drawing, the marks, and it varies. But you have something like this that works like that, but it probably fits in all together. Each one fits in all together. There's a continuation. There's something in the craft, there's a mechanics that goes on that's very complicated and subtle. And once you start doing something, you sort of help do it some more, you know. But it doesn't mean that you've invented anything or you come to a conclusion. It means that you're solving this specific act. Yes?
So which of these paintings help one another evolve?
None. And all.
You're being...
Well, it's so complicated. It's so complicated. I don't follow...
Okay, no, for example, you specifically mentioned, like, that being the second Ram painting.
Well, yeah, the same setup.
So you could say that one helped that one evolve.
Oh yeah, I could say, you could say that.
Okay.
If you want to be an snob and intellectual. But I haven't done it before.
Right.
It's just that I was setting up a setup that all of a sudden at just this much difference, I found something that made it really, really secure and strong. Mm-hmm. And I liked it.
Yeah.
So you gotta do this. But then then keep me from doing the one on a sunny day.
Right. So you said all and none. What do you mean by that?
What?
You said that none of them.
Well, I mean, I'm a normal human being, and I have memories, and I have things that I prefer and admire and thought remembered like that. And then, but when I'm doing something, I don't relate it. It happens.
So it's like literal proximity, like maybe it gets you to the point of starting to work on something?
I don't know. I mean, I never did a painting like that one before in my life.
That one?
Yeah. And it took me 4 months. And I found out I had to find out more close valued tones. And how do you make them rich? I can get the tone, but I can't get a good color. Get a good color, but then I can't lose the tone. I mean, it's very delicate, and there's very specific differences I think I'm more alert to now than I ever have been before in my life, you know.
Does it ever matter if you're working on, like some of these are sunny day paintings or cloudy day paintings, where you have two going at the same time?
Nothing makes any difference. When I was in Rome, I was working all day on 8 paintings. 71, I was there. I worked from one to the other, to the other, to the other, to the other. And they turned out okay. Don't have anything better to do. Any other questions? Come on.
Just what did you do that one behind the stone?
Behind the what?
The orchids.
Out in your backyard. I think it's
the flower
and
the orchids?
The flower and, the orchids.
What about it?
When?
I don't know. It's dated, isn't it? What's it say, Meg?
Last year.
No idea. 12 December 2016.
I just wondered if it was like 10 years ago.
Oh no, no, these are all this past since the last show.
Oh, okay. All right, I didn't know that.
Yeah, no, they're all from 2015.
All new. 15.
Except for the ones you brought in. Okay.
Oh no, these are.
Yeah. Okay.
That's 58, and that's 60.